So thank you, Heather, very much for that introduction to the subject that we're discussing this evening, and for giving us an indication not just of the scale of the problem, but also some fantastic ideas for the solution. Yeah. And I'm pleased to say that on our panel tonight, we have three speakers who've come in this evening to be able to talk to us about some of the solutions which they're adopting in their companies. And to start us off, before we open up and talk through some of the issues across this whole chain of solution that we hope to reach in the course of this evening, I'd like to give our panellists an opportunity to just give us each a three-minute introduction to what it is that they're doing in their companies, so we hear from them on some of the responses and solutions that they've adopted. So I'd like to introduce Tom Dorman, who's the Long-Term Innovation Manager at Ecover and Method, and Fiona Ball from Sky, and Daniella Vega from Selfridges. Who are we starting with first? Tom, would you like to go first, please?
Okay. Well, thank you. So indeed, very shortly, I'll try to give a perspective on why we started doing our project, which was called Ocean Bottle. And it basically was started at the beginning, even the foundation of our company, that was started from the idea of really tackling the impact of everyday products on water quality. So looking back like more than 30 years ago when the company was founded, it was all about the chemicals that were used in everyday products like cleaning products, looking at phosphate specifically, looking what they did to water, to marine life, to health in the end, as it's all connected. And over the years, we kind of looked at those kind of impact of chemicals, and we kind of looked for formulations and chemicals which has no impact on water, which are all biodegradable. But then about 5 years ago, we started looking at, okay, what is the issue currently today with water quality? What are like the biggest threats to water quality and health related issues on water quality? And indeed, we really were amazed as well by the big scale of ocean plastic even at the time when we started looking into it. So we were questioning, challenging ourselves a little bit. Do we have like enough solutions also to address that part of the ocean plastic that is like a huge issue currently today? And so we started a program, which is our Ocean Bottle final result. And the program started, first of all, like, let's do everything we can today already to be part of the solution, which is about making sure you use as much as recycled content as possible in our bottles, which we do. Making sure you use plant-based, if not recycled content, making sure we offer consumers the option to reuse the bottles, refill and reuse the bottles. And then we started our program, which was about three things: raising awareness with our consumers around the big issue ocean plastic is. Secondly, start being part of a solution instead of being part of a problem. As we were selling plastic bottles, we went out in the ocean, we collaborated with fishermen, with beach cleanups, to collect the plastic and turn it into bottles, which was the first ocean bottle that was made. Then thirdly, we started to look into the real design problem, which basically ocean plastic is for me a real design problem. Let's fix it from the source. Let's reinvent how single-use packaging is made today. Let's reinvent the material. Let's reinvent the way of dealing with single-use packaging. So ocean plastic is no longer an issue overall.
Thank you for that introduction to what you've been doing. That's really helpful for helping to set the scene for us. Fiona, can I ask you, there's been a recent shift, hasn't there, after 6 years of supporting the rainforest campaign. Sky have now moved into this big, big shift into oceans. Can you talk us through a little bit how you got to there?
Yeah, sure. So I think Sky Rainforest Rescue really sort of like proved to us that as a media organisation, we had a real opportunity to inspire and engage people on complex environmental issues. You know, over 6 years working with WWF, we managed to reach 7 million people and encourage 1.5 million people to actually change their behaviour as a result of it. So we wanted to look at what the next environmental challenge was, that we could really use our media organisation to really raise awareness and bring all the issues and challenges and solutions to the forefront. Oceans, we realise, is an awful lot going on. An awful lot's been going on for, you know, a few years now around it, and we really thought we now was the right opportunity to sort of build the groundswell of understanding and awareness of what the issues and the challenges were, to really enable particular projects to make a difference. So we went out and we asked, as we do, our customers, what challenge would we like us to look at? And 80% of our news viewers said they would like us to look at plastics and pollution, and particularly single-use plastics, as the next issue. So we've set a campaign to really raise awareness. We've got 20 million customers across Europe. We want to use our news channels in Italy, TG24, looking at European issues of the Med as well, because they're really suffering from plastics and also toxicity on their beaches. And also use our other media channels to really raise awareness of this issue.
Thank you. So that's really interesting that it was actually consumers that fed back to you that that was a big issue for them, and that helped in your choice.
Yeah, no, definitely, definitely. Yeah.
And Daniella, it was fascinating to hear from Heather a little bit about what you've been doing in Selfridges. Can you talk us through a bit more how you got to that as a choice for Selfridges and what that involved?
Well, Selfridges is a family-run business, and it all started after a pretty disastrous COP15, I think it was, in 2009. And so Jonathan Bailey, a director at ZSL, was talking to Alana Weston, who is our deputy chairman and family member, and they were just sort of discussing COP and what an uninspiring event it had been. And Alana said to Jonathan, well, if you environmentalists could sell ocean issues like a retailer could, then you might get somewhere. And so the the gauntlet was laid down. And so Project Ocean was born in 2011, and it was a partnership with the Zoological Society of London to raise awareness of overfishing, so the dangers of overfishing and pollution in the ocean. And so since 2011, we've done everything from investing in marine reserves in the British Overseas Territories, to building capacity, bringing NGOs together who are working on these issues to collaborate, looking at our own operations, so tackling unsustainable fishing through never serving or selling endangered fish in our restaurants and our food halls, to looking at beauty products, taking squalene, which is shark oil, out of our beauty products, and microbeads, to getting rid of plastic bags, and in 2015 to going single-use plastic water bottle free, and trying to persuade our customers to move from the kind of grab and go, so providing more sustainable alternatives to the reusable bottle.
Thank you. So that's, I think, really helpful for setting the scene for why we're here tonight, and the different approaches that three companies have taken, where you've got some strands in common and some where you've gone down a different route. And I'd quite like to follow a little bit more the role of the consumer in this, and where they come in, and how that's impacted on you. And Jim alluded at the beginning to this kind of something in the zeitgeist at the moment, maybe, or something in the water about ocean plastics, that it seems to have really hit peak public interest right now in the media, with the UN war on plastics, with the report at WEF. And I wonder, Tom, if you'd like to comment on that. Have we reached peak ocean plastic now? Is this the issue of the moment, or is this going to be something that will last? It's got traction to follow on through.
Years.
Yeah, absolutely. So it's not going to go away soon. Definitely, the issue is going to stay at least, like you said, for 1,000 years. We're not going to be able to clean up the whole ocean plastics very soon. The good thing indeed is that you see that traction both with consumers as with companies indeed trying to do something. My only caveat there is, let's not push everything towards consumers, because it's easy to say that companies say, okay, consumers need to change their habits and they need to kind of change the way they deal with plastic. I think we also need to rethink plastic and packaging on itself as really challenge it as a design failure as it is today, and not just only try to change consumer behaviour.
So I think that's a good steer, actually. Fiona, can I put that one back over to you? So to what degree is this becoming a problem for business? It can't be only about consumers and about changing behaviour. What are the implications of this for business?
No, exactly. I mean, it's a bit like opening Pandora's box, to be perfectly honest. When you decide to do a campaign like this, you have to look at your own house as well, and just how much single-use plastics you use as an organisation. So we've made a start by getting rid of all single-use water bottles and finding alternative with coolers and sparkling water and still water for our employees, which is going to save over 200,000 water bottles a year in its own, the amount that we sell. But yes, we're having to look at coffee cups, the coffee lids that go in coffee cups, also our packaging for all of our products. Obviously, when we started to have a look at all the set-top boxes that we distribute on a yearly basis, the amount of single-use plastics and used in packaging is incredible. So it is a process that we are going to go on with our consumers and look at the solutions, look at the alternatives, see where we can get rid of any packaging as a start, but then also look at whether there's also alternatives, because a lot of packaging is good. It's used for a reason. It's used to protect things that are distributed. So we can't, you know, say that we're going to get rid of absolutely everything altogether, but we are going to go on that journey, and it's quite a big journey to go on.
Mm-hmm. And I think what's quite interesting is it's quite a short period of time that we've been so devoted to plastic, isn't it, and wrapping everything up in plastic and having it in our lives. You know, in our parents' lifetime, we might have been more dependent on brown paper bags and cardboard. And certainly in America, you can still get your shopping in a brown paper bag, don't you? You don't have a plastic bag. It's very interesting, quite a short-term time that we've been thinking about it as, yes, we must have this thing shrink-wrapped in plastic.
Yeah.
So, Daniella, can I ask you, do you think that, to some degree, businesses have been getting away with this for a little bit of time and not taking their responsibilities for this seriously and trying to put it back on the consumer? Is there scope for thinking about the role that businesses can have to play in this?
I absolutely think that should be the approach. But I do think it's not a siloed, it's either business, it's legislation, or it's consumer. And I think the systems map that the One Less team have drawn is great, because it sets out where all the levers are. So there's absolutely levers around customer behaviour change and business behaviour change, but there's also a role for legislation. But I think for businesses it's hard, and for retailers it's hard, because plastic is so cheap. And so when we started on this journey to look at our supply chain and our retail operations and try and work through it and get rid of single-use plastics, we found it very difficult, and particularly around food, where you know, as Fiona says, there's a reason that things are that plastic is used, because food needs to, it's a food safety issue, but also it's a behavioural issue. So for example, when I took away the plastic lids from our deli pots in our bakery and replaced them with card, the sales dropped, because people like to see what they're buying before they buy it. So it's not just a case of even if you can get like for like on a price point, it's not a case of swapping them out. You have to do quite a lot of work around the behaviour change as well.
That's really interesting, isn't it? The tweaking that you need to do to get consumers to be able to engage with this and to feel somehow safe and secure that this is okay for them to do. So Fiona, can I just ask you, is there something about this issue that is it not resonating so well with consumers compared to some issues, for example, now on climate change? That's a sort of given, isn't it? We've got over the hump on having the debate about climate change, or at least in many media outlets, not all, should we say. But is there more work to be done there that we need to do to help change attitudes?
I think it's just making people aware of the amount of plastics and single-use plastics we do use. I think it's a bit like when climate change was first discussed, we used things like carbon calculators to help people actually understand and realise just how much carbon and energy we do use as individuals in their own home. And I think the stats like, you know, a family uses a truckloads of plastics per year is kind of really good stats to kind of help people visualise just how much they do use. So at the moment we're doing things in our next part of the campaign is we've got a lot of our editorial team that are actually doing pilots at home, just, you know, collecting all the kind of single-use plastics that they actually use at home and pulling them all together, and then just realising just what a kind of huge volume it is. I think it's hidden. A lot of the things that we buy, even if you think that you are buying something that doesn't have a huge amount of plastics, when you go to the groceries and stuff like that, is actually probably ended up in the grocers. you know, wrapped in plastic as part of its transportation. So I think it's just awareness, it's an understanding, and it's not until you, like we have done as a business, start looking at actually how much do we do use and, you know, uncovering it, that you actually realise just how much of a problem it is, to be perfectly honest.
So there's that key step then, isn't there, on consumer attitudes, first of all, to get that awareness, to get that understanding, this is what you use a day, this is what as a family you're using in a month, and actually to see the pile and then to understand. And so, Tom, if you've got to the next step, if you like, what are the consumer actions that you would be encouraging for business to move on to the next level after that, once you've got the awareness-raising piece of the puzzle? What's your next step that you would advise from what you're learning in Ecover?
Definitely, I think the refill option, there's loads of opportunities to reuse packaging. I mean, having a material that lasts for 1,000 years and just use it once looks a little bit silly in the end. So there's loads of opportunities to reuse, refill. But the issue there is indeed how to get refill and reuse into retailers. There are, again, some legislational challenges. There's food safety issues. So it's a big challenge, but I think if we all collaborate together, it is possible. We once did a trial indeed on offering refill detergent in supermarkets environment, but indeed, if it's just one brand, single brand does it, and then you have like a different thing in the shelf versus the other ones. So if you would like all together offer a refill in store, that would be really, really step change in consumer demand. It's just as long as people get it. Easy choice of picking a bottle from the shelf, they will never switch to another behavior. So we kind of need to change that system in all at once almost.
Yes. So I found it fascinating to hear from Heather's presentation and then a bit more from Daniella about what had actually been done in Selfridges and how you managed to do it. And I talked to Jim beforehand and I bought my prop. This is my last single-use water bottle. I brought it in this evening so you can all see it and then you can hold me to account later. And then the other thing I brought in is this thing. This is also plastic, but it's so that you can. It's so small you can't forget. So you can fit it in your pocket and then you've got your own single-use bottle. But Heather, can you just talk us through a bit more this incredible collaboration that you talked about between ZSL and Selfridges and how you managed to get that to that incredible cross-section of collaborators and contributors and to build that momentum and get that single-use water bottle issue out there so successfully in the way that you described it?
Yeah, I mean, as Daniella said, that the partnership started from a conversation which was a gauntlet thrown, if you like, and an unlikely but obvious partnership in hindsight is, and what Alana Weston said to my boss was basically environmentalists spend far too much time talking to each other and far too much time talking about problems and not solutions. And so he turned that around and said, well, you spend your whole time trying to influence people to do things, i.e. buy things in your store or come to your store. You set trends as an organisation, and so please help us. And I think that's what's been so exciting about the partnership is Selfridges have reached new audiences who would never come and listen to me talking or go to an environmental talk, but would go to an event in Selfridges or something that window designs that have been created to communicate key messages in an amazing visual soundbite that you kind of see as you go on a bus down Oxford Street in a way that me giving endless talks would never be able to reach. So the power of communication, the reaching wider audiences, making it easy for people. So Selfridges' initial transformation to sustainable seafood, no longer serving endangered fish, means that you could go in with a clear conscience and not worry about it. Likewise, if you go in and buy water, you're getting it in a more ocean-friendly way, and they're making it easy by having free refill stations around the store. And that was one of the most odd feedback, was that nobody could believe you could go and get something for free, as in healthy drinking water from a tap from Selfridges. So I think it is that it has to be about simplicity, it has to be solutions focused, and then where the solutions don't exist, as Tom said, it's working on with innovation and design teams, with research groups, with out there thinkers who are going to sort of take the topic and really make those changes happen.
And I think what's fascinating for me is that to think about for Selfridges, you had permission, didn't you, Daniella? The way you've described it, from the very top, you had a sort of crisis, if you like, with COP15 and what are we going to do? And then you got permission from the very top of the organisation, and then you had this fantastic link with ZSL. So for some people in the audience, they might be thinking that is a fantastic combination of circumstances that enabled Selfridges to move forward. But I'd just like you to, if you can, invite you to share some of the difficulties that you encountered on the way to get to where Selfridges has got to now, because the story is so good to get to the end of the story. But for people in the room, can you help us with what some of the difficulties were that you had to overcome to get to where you are now?
Yeah, sure. It was quite difficult. It was not an easy journey. So the way it worked was we with ZSL, we decided we wanted to focus on single-use plastic water bottles. And so my task was set for me that I had to get them out of the shop, which seems quite easy. But we're a shop with shops within shops. So we have concession models as well as the stuff that we buy ourselves. So after months of meetings with the restaurants and food director, I went back to Ilana and I said, well, what we can do is we can stop buying it ourselves, but there's no way. I've talked to all our concessions. You know, we've got all of the major coffee shops and Starbucks and Eat and Pret and all of those organisations within our shop. And I went back to her and said, so they've said no, so I'm afraid we'll just do our own bought stuff, but we can't do the concessions. And I guess that's where having a family-owned business with a very passionate owner helped, because she said, if you're not going to do everything, don't do anything at all, because our customers don't know the difference between concessions and own bought. So we went back to them and said, we this is what's happening in our shop. Please get on board. And we kind of backtracked. So with Starbucks, for example, we ended up buying their water for them and giving it to them whilst they could work out how to change their delivery so that we got no plastic into the store. So it wasn't, it was a great outcome, but it was a pretty hairy year up until that point.
All right, so you had like a year of transition, if you like, where you had to work through some of these challenges like the concessions and to get there. But all the time you had the backing from the top and you had the collaboration, so those were key things to help you to get there.
And I hope I'm right in saying it helped ZSL then do the same thing with their business, because it was just as tough for Heather to go back to ZSL and attempt the same thing there.
But then by then you had the Selfridges model, if you like, to be able to draw upon and to illustrate that it can be done?
We did. We're not immediately comparable as a business type, as a visitor attraction for families with a slightly less luxury market. So we had to rethink it as to what worked for us. So I think the important thing that we've been doing is building the evidence and the facts to support Selfridges and look at, you know, building what alternatives exist and making better choices where the perfect solution isn't available. And then we had a different situation in the London Zoo and Whipsnade Zoo sites because, but actually in some ways easier, because if you only serve one kind of more ocean-friendly water, then that's all your customers can buy. It's simpler. We don't have to provide a suite of retail options, a range or anything. It's just, and obviously because we're an educational charity as well, we built it into all of our activities. So if you go and see the penguins, you'll get a discussion all around plastic and you know, the impact it has on the ocean. So we've embedded it right the way across the organisation.
Oh, so it's become part of your education offer part as well,
So it's part of the education. It's a big features in the restaurant, so people understand why, and we've trained all the staff to be able to explain. And I think one of the key things is that it affects everybody. I spend a lot of my time talking about the ocean, which feels very remote, far away, distant, and it's quite hard to communicate or at least engage people, because people don't feel it's directly relevant to them. I think with plastic, everybody, every day, is in contact with plastic and making choices about what they buy and what they do with it. So whether they, you know, how rigorous they are on recycling, etc. So across the staff, it's been fantastic to see. We've got real ambassadors, people really inspire to be involved, who work in finance, retail, health and safety, not just the conservationists who might be more typically involved.
Thank you. So we've talked a little bit about the role of awareness raising, haven't we, and consumers and behaviour change, and we've talked a bit about a couple of businesses and some of the different approaches you've taken. But Tom, one of the big things I understand that ICA have done has been right at the forefront of innovating your way as one of the ways of addressing this problem. So can you talk to us a little bit more about that role of innovation as part of the suite of solutions that we can be adopting to address ocean plastics?
Yes, so first of all, there's innovation indeed on how do we ramp up recycling rates, the use of recycled material in our bottles, the use of indeed lesser quality plastic like ocean plastic, how you put that back into a value recycling chain. So we did a lot of partnerships with recyclers, with plastic manufacturers, to make sure that we come up to maximum levels of recycled content in our bottles. We currently have 100% recycled PET bottles, which look fantastic, and it's the highest recycling rate that you can find on the market. They still look great. So it took a lot of innovation. It took a lot of partnerships to get there. I think the next level for us is to, like I said, redesign the material itself. We need to be able, and I think I'm really convinced we can do that, we need to rethink plastic as a material to keep its kind of good properties like lightweight, transparency, barrier properties, but design it in a way it becomes almost ocean or nature benign. So design a material like nature would do. There's not such a thing as ocean banana peels or ocean coconut shells. Those things have been designed by nature to package goods in a way that it's kind of benign to nature. And I think the next kind of horizon for us is to crack that kind of material challenge. And we're really kind of talking to real like forefront startups who are cracking that kind of challenge. And there's some amazing materials out there. It's really a matter of businesses supporting those kind of new innovation startups to bring that material to market.
Mm. And was that then a race to bring that material to market, or is it part of a broader collaboration? So
it should be a collaboration, because of course if you look at those startups, the challenge they have is getting to a scale. So they often start with the disadvantage of having a lot higher pricing, because they're just a small startup, and so the material doesn't get any chance, and the big industries are not really interested unless the material is like really in big scale available on the market. So what we try to do is offer them kind of in-between solution, trying to give them a route to market, which doesn't require the big scales of the big FMCGs, but do kind of prototyping, maybe test markets of that material, and you know, make them scale so they can really survive and build a business case.
Okay, so you might be on the round tables later on and networking in the drinks afterwards to talk to people who might be interested in this sort of thing.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. So Fiona, can I ask you, are there other pressure points that could be thought about for this ocean plastics problem? Is it about going to AGMs and talking to shareholders? Is it a share action type issue? Is it a big NGO issue with, you know, another one of these Greenpeace or Friends of the Earth campaigns? Are there other elements that we haven't discussed that we should be sort of bringing into the room?
I think as Daniela said, it's something that everybody needs to get involved in. You know, whether it's the policy debate, the legislation debate, the business debate about what you need to do, the consumer debate, the legal and policy debate is a really big one. There's lots of different things that are currently standing in the way of some really great solutions to ocean plastic problems. And also just the protection of our oceans through the marine protection areas is something that is being piloted in the UK and just needs to be fast-tracked. You know, we really need to look at the ocean as a beautiful place, and the areas that are pristine need to be protected as that. And so I think it's more the fact of just everybody looking at what their role is that they can bring to the table and what they need to do effectively.
Mm. So several of you have talked about this. There's the role of collaboration, and I think perhaps maybe you haven't used the word, but there was something about convening power going on, wasn't there, between ZSL and Selfridges? and the fact that then you've got that much bigger coalition involved to support you in that. So is there something about this use of these different actors in the system to enable change that either of you would like to talk about a bit more? How you went from being a partnership to being essentially a collaboration of, I don't know how many it is in the end, when you put up on the screen?
I think the philosophy of Project Ocean was very much an opportunity to bring the marine conservation organisations across the UK together and provide them with a platform to communicate. So it started out as a very strongly collaborative initiative, and ZSL has a long history for its convening power. So I think it is a case with these topics that it's a case of moving beyond egos and logos and actually thinking about how we fix things together. And the problem in this case is so vast that we do need different expertise from the whole suite of the NGO to business collaboration. So there's nine NGOs, and we were actually supported by the Kalusa Gulbenkian Foundation, who brought us together to say, you know, what kind of experiments can we do that we do together, that we can make a bigger difference by working together, and that leveraged off the Project Ocean transformation and enabled us to take it to scale.
Mm. So it's interesting, use that word leverage, how the one thing enabled you to leverage something else and then something else. Yep. One thing that I still don't think I quite understand is this, on the role of technology and breakthroughs, and trying to understand a bit more about what you said, Tom, about what benign plastic looks like. I'm wondering if you or Heather, have got more to say about this role of technology in enabling some of these breakthroughs, because we've talked a bit about consumers and about collaborations, and I'm still trying to understand where the technological breakthroughs are in this.
You go.
Like I said, I think those type of new materials are, we're just looking at the beginning of what they can deliver. So there's lots of research going on. It's about capturing waste and turn that into that kind of benign materials. Now, that doesn't mean, I think the technology route is definitely only one part of the solution. I think we do need to be careful in placing all our bets on some kind of new material and new technology. Like you said in the beginning as well, it's kind of the and. So we need technology, and at the same time, we need to use less of the material. We need to have like things like the behavioral change, the refill, the recycling. So all those parallel tracks, we kind of need to move forward in a kind of similar pace. And in the end solution will be a combination of the kind of new material, high recycling rates for specific, very specific materials that are really efficient to recycle, and then just use less of it in the end.
Mm. Heather, did you want to add anything on that? Are there breakthrough technological solutions that we haven't talked about yet that we should be? There's quite a few big bottling companies around that I'm sure would be very, very interested in seeing if there are other ways to sell product that can include a benign plastic.
Yeah, well, as a fish biologist, I don't feel as I wouldn't want to preach that. I think it is, what we've been seeing is really understanding the full life cycle costs of the current sort of reusable options, what's the perfect refill bottle, and what should that be made of? So we've given everybody one tonight that's made of plastic. So that obviously asks the question. Obviously, you can use it for multiple times. But obviously, we're still on the search for the perfect refillable and the perfect to-go bottle. So if somebody just needs one quickly. There's also behavioural barriers. We've been having some wonderful conversations with a number of sporting institutions, but some won't let you go in with a lid on. So then if you encourage people to use refillables, that's not going to work in that context. What do we do for things events like the London Marathon? What's the for athletes who are doing that, who need hydration during that race, how can we provide them with water in a way that doesn't litter the streets of London with 50,000 plastic water bottles in a single day? So there's different challenges in different circumstances. I think what's exciting about taking it at as a systems change on a London scale, obviously that's scalable and replicable, but also I feel with this being, you know, the design capital of the world and all, a wonderful innovation, is that there's a brain somewhere within the M25 who has that answer, and it's just a case of leveraging more collaborations, and hopefully some of those are in this room tonight.
I think there are some really cool alternatives out there, and ultimately, I brought some with me. So with Project Ocean, we collaborated with a SIG design bottle and developed that, which was quite popular. But for the grab-and-go crowd, which there will always be, the consumer, there's this can of water, which is super cool because it's reusable, because it's got a resealable lid, and it's made with recycled material as well. So it's kind of taking which, and I've got other Tetra Pak examples, which has much less plastic and better plastic. So I think it's the journey to the reusable vessel, isn't it, that we want to encourage. But there are, I mean, when we stopped selling single-use plastic water bottles, we were inundated by very small brands who developed alternatives. But I agree with Heather. There's definitely, I mean, this is not the greatest design. I mean, it's pretty standard. I think there's a massive opportunity for a reusable bottle that's also very stylish and cool to be developed.
Becomes the go-to thing that we all must have.
Yes.
Yeah. Like the new file of fax or the new iPhone or the new, like, we must all have the bottle. Yeah. And you could have it in many different colours and, yeah. You can
but
just
also,
imagine.
Yeah, but some of the barriers that we've identified is it's harder, apparently, that for men to switch, because men often don't have a bag with them. So then carrying a refillable becomes a burden rather than something that you know, rather than if you've got a handbag. So big up the man bag, I guess, is the solution there. Yeah.
But, it's the next breakthrough, isn't it? You need your man bag for the water.
I think if we're sort of understanding what will make people switch and what will incentivize people to switch. I think the other thing that's important is, as Tom said, is that plastic bottles are easy to recycle, one of the few products that are, but they're not being recycled. And so I think although reduction is a very big part of the story, actually looking at people finding recycling very, very confusing and not realizing that contamination can mean it can't be recycled. So clarifying, streamlining, improving recycling trains to get up to the Ecover example, where we are achieving not 50% or 30% or whatever rates of recycling, but near as 100% as we possibly can. And, you know, if you walk down Oxford Street, there's a recycling bin every 10 steps going all the way down there, but it's full of other rubbish. So there is a big, you know, change about people recognising that even when you make it easy, things have got to be... behaviour has to change to do it properly.
Yeah, but I think because the reason why I think recycling is currently so ineffective is because there are, like, thousands of different layers and laminates and materials and plastics around for single-use consumer goods. So why don't we streamline everything that is sold as a single-use consumer good? We give it kind of clearer directions on what type of plastic does it need to be. Make it always transparent. Don't, like, color it with different colors. So make sure that at least whenever we use durable plastics for single-use consumer goods, that it's kind of restricted in the variety of marketing options you get from it, and that you limit yourself really to those kind of streams, create clear streams, create value for those streams. So the recyclers in the end who have a really hard time to survive currently because they have to sort out all these different types. They have to, I mean, what from every kilo they get in, they probably need to throw away half of it because it's polluted with all these different laminates and layers and colors. So let's create clearer recycling streams and improve that chain to make it a lot more efficient as we know today.
Mm, so something about the existing supply chain, being clear about that, as well as the reducing and the reusing.
So every London borough has a different recycling system.
Yeah.
So that means you might just crack it and then move house, and then you've got to sort of work it all out again. So I think there is a huge thing on clarity, simplicity and transparency.
So maybe that's something for the cities to pick up on then, isn't it? The resilient cities and the C40 cities, that could be a citywide thing like San Francisco or, you know, the target for London, and do it that way. So I'm conscious now that what would perhaps be really helpful for our audience is that we could think about what would be the one thing that each of you would recommend that as a business you could do, but also as an individual, all the individuals in this room, each one of you could be the one who's going to make the difference, the one who's going to do the big change. You're the ocean entrepreneur, the dreamers who do, the ones that actually make the change. You know, what's going to be the kind of Skunk Works equivalent for ocean plastics? And I'd just like to invite each of you to come back with what your thought would be as an individual for everyone in the room, but also as a business. So, Fiona, can I give you the chance to go first this time?
Sure. So I think as a business, the biggest thing you can do is actually speak to your employees about this, because the biggest groundswell of action in our business has been the employees and the interest that the employees have been of getting behind the campaign. So we were, when you make any changes to your operations or your food facilities in an organisation, it's always a little bit worrying about how it will be taken. But we had 70 people and 70 comments of people really interested in sharing ideas of what else we can do as the next step of tackling plastics in our business. So the first thing I would do is talk to your people and get that so the advocates, the natural advocates within your business, to get behind you and share ideas of what they can do. The biggest thing that I would say that you could do is as an individual yourself is just look at yourself and your family and just see how much plastic you do. Just the awareness piece and the understanding just how much you are using as a consumer, and just identify quick wins of what you can do to reduce that.
Thank you. Tom?
So for businesses, I always have a hard time to focus on one thing. I want to do all these different things. But so if I really have to choose like one thing, for me, indeed, it goes back to going to the real fundamental issues of why this is a problem. So going after the design challenge of putting money behind research into new materials, making sure that we design materials differently to not to cause an issue like ocean plastic, to make that go away. So it would definitely be my number one. And then as a consumer, probably it's probably that kind of reuse. It's a bit like being conscious about how much plastic you use and where you can like reuse. I think the bottle example of Selfridges is great, where you can just refill bottles, especially for water. That's clear, but just reuse and refill as much as possible.
Daniella?
I think for a business, map your supply chain and just see where your usage is around single-use plastics. When I did that, it was a really big spreadsheet. And it can seem really daunting, but when you start to kind of map it out, then you can just you can phase your approach and tackle it one single-use plastic at a time. My thing about individuals is probably go to the ocean and have a look at it, because I think for me it's when it hit home. Where I was lucky enough to go to the Philippines with Heather and the ZSL team, and we did a beach clean on an island in the Philippines. Which was quite a moving experience for me, because I was so unprepared at what I saw there. It was quite literally people living on an island of plastic. There was plastic in the ocean. There was plastic making up the beach. And after a kind of half day beach clean with 200 people, we hadn't made a dent in it. And it was really moving. And the other kind of thing about it was, you know, they had no infrastructure to take away these plastics. So you don't have to go to the Philippines. You can go to your nearest Thames shore and just see it with your own eyes, because it will really it will really give you that kind of emotional connection to the issue.
Heather?
Well, I kind of have, I guess I've said it already. I mean, I think you've got to start somewhere, and that's why we picked the single-use plastic water bottle as our kind of flagship species for ocean plastic. I think that's something, as an individual, everybody could do from today. Organisations, I'd love more businesses to look like Sky, like Selfridges, obviously, Ecover, about how to go one less as well. And then by just taking that one topic and one item, it firstly opens up the rest of it, and secondly allows you to look at how you change that system, whether it's your supply or what alternatives are going to work for you. The more case studies we can document and share, the more people can look at a portfolio and say, oh, that would work for my business, or that wouldn't work. And then we start narrowing down where the real points where we've got to look at technological solutions or others, and then which are the best partners to do that.
Thank you. So lots and lots of pieces in the chain there, and suggestions and ideas for what we can do both as individuals but also within our businesses.